I'd like to begin with a story. A man was traveling down the road from Jerusalem to Jericho, where he fell among robbers and thieves, who beat him and stripped him and left him half dead. By chance, a priest was passing that way, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side of the road. Likewise, a Levite, when he came to where the man was in the road, he too passed by on the other side. But then a Samaritan. When he came to the place where the man was lying in the road, he saw him and he had compassion. And he treated the man's wounds with his own oil and wine, and he bandaged them. And he placed him on his own animal, and he walked him to the nearby town and took him to the inn. And there he cared for him all night long. And in the morning, he went to the innkeeper and he gave him 2 denarii, 2 days' wages. And he said, "Whatever else it costs, when I return, I'll pay it." We've learned this week that this story that is well known and most famous was not told in a vacuum, but rather Jesus was answering a lawyer's questions. A lawyer had asked him, "What shall I do to inherit eternal life?" But Jesus had turned the tables back on him and asked him, "Well, how does the law read to you?" And the fellow said, "Well, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus told him, that's it. Do that and you'll live. And the man said, "Well, yeah, but who's my neighbor?" And that's when Jesus tells this story. And we've recognized this week that Jesus' shocking and challenging answer to the question, "Who is my neighbor?" was essentially, "Well, lawyer, I don't know. Who would you want to be your neighbor if you were the one lying on the road, having been beaten and robbed?" And when Jesus tells the man, "Go and do likewise to the lawyer," we've recognized what kind of next level love this is, that's not seeking for limitations and lines, but trying to be unbounded and just continuing to see not who do I have to love, but how can I love more? Those are the kind of challenges that Jesus is issuing to us in this story that we've read in Luke chapter 10. But I want to back up tonight, and I want us to think about, why did he ask this question? Why did the man ask the question to begin with? And as we consider his reasons for asking, I want to look at us and put us in the mirror to see if we are sometimes like this lawyer, seeking to justify himself. Before we consider the answers to those questions, would you bow with me in prayer, please? God and Father in heaven, you are magnificent and awesome. You are wonderful and amazing. You have loved us more than we deserve, and you continue to love us. You pour your rain down upon those who are righteous and those who are unrighteous. You send your sunshine on those who are just and those who are unjust. And you sent your Son to die for us, that we might have hope of eternity with you, earnest expectation, not wishful thinking, but expectation of being with you for all time because of the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Because he saw us beaten and afflicted by sin and by Satan, and he has come and he has paid the price that we might be healed. And Father, thank you for that. Help us tonight to be honest as we look in the mirror of your word, that we might see where we fall short and where we seek to justify ourselves, that we might recognize that there is no justifying ourselves, that justification can only come through the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to be challenged to grow to be more like him in the days to come. We love you, Father, and we thank you for loving us first. Through your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. So why did the lawyer ask these questions? If you look in Luke chapter 10, we recognize the first question that he asked there in Luke chapter 10 and verse 25. "Behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?'" Notice it does not say that a lawyer stood up seeking to find an answer to one of his long-held questions. It does not say that a lawyer stood up trying to put some kind of controversy to rest. It does not say that a lawyer stood up because he was struggling and stumbling and wondering and needing help. What it says is that a lawyer stood up seeking to put Jesus to the test. The reality is, we recognize that the reason he asked this question is to make Jesus look bad. I don't know why he thought this would be a testing question. I'm not sure what he expected Jesus to say. I kind of imagine that what the lawyer was thinking is that this was such a broad and general and vague question that he just figured that no matter what Jesus said, there would probably be something that he could latch hold of to make Jesus look bad in front of the others. That Jesus would either go too far or he wouldn't go far enough. And in doing that, the lawyer would be able to make him look bad. He would be able to accuse him of error and false teaching to the Jews that were around him so that he could turn them away from following him. I don't know exactly what it was that he thought was going to happen, but I'm guessing that the lawyer thought way too much of his own understanding of the law and not enough of Jesus' understanding of the law. And so he asked this question in order to put Jesus to the test. He asked this question in order to make Jesus look bad. The problem is, when you're having a battle of wits with the master teacher, you're always going to come out on the wrong end of this deal. And that's exactly what happens. Jesus turns the tables on him and he says, "Well, how does it sound to you?" Now, this lawyer was not the sharpest knife in the drawer. Had he been, he'd have said, "Hey, I asked first." But instead, he went ahead and tried to respond. And I think that demonstrates perhaps some of his own personal arrogance that when he had opportunity to speak, he had to. "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said, "There you go. You do that, you'll live. That's it. That's the law. That's the prophets. You do those things and you'll live." But then he asked a second question. And the second question, if you look there in Luke chapter 10, it doesn't say that a lawyer standing up to have clarification. It doesn't say that a lawyer trying to deal with some type of long-held controversy that was going on among the Jews. What does it say in verse 29? "But he, desiring to justify himself, said, 'Who is my neighbor?'" Why did he ask this second question? He asked this second question in order to make himself look good. The first question he asked to try to make Jesus look bad, now he's asking a question not from the genuineness of his heart, not because he loves Jesus and trusts Jesus and wants to know what Jesus' answer is, but he's asking this question because he's seeking to justify himself. He's been caught in a trap. He realized that he has made himself look bad. He's asked a question as if he just really wanted to know the answer and yet has now demonstrated that he knew the answer all along. It's been demonstrated that he was not asking from pure and genuine motives, and so now he's trying to make himself look good. "Oh, no, I really was asking from pure, genuine motives. I mean, I know, I understand that if I want eternal life, I need to love God and I need to love my neighbor. My problem is, I don't know who my neighbor is." Now, I want us to think through this idea of trying to make himself look good. And what does it mean that he was seeking to justify himself? When we consider this idea of him justifying himself, this is what happens whenever we haven't done what we're supposed to do. Whenever we've done something wrong and we've been caught or we know we've done something wrong, things are now out of whack and out of kilter. There's some dissonance. There's some disharmony. And we don't like that sort of thing. What we want to do is to try to make everything be back in harmony. And so we're going to try to get it all back and make it look right. And that's where we justify ourselves. Now, we have a couple of options there. We can either just say, "Well, there's no justifying what I did, and I'll just ask for forgiveness." That's what we can do because that's what God offers. Or we can try to act like, "No, I didn't do anything wrong to begin with," and we justify it or we excuse it. For instance, when we say, no, "This isn't gossip. This is just a prayer request about some sin that I know a person is committing that I thought you'd want to know about." Or, "No, I wasn't lusting. I was just admiring beauty." Those kinds of justifications. The lawyer is trying to smooth things over and make things look good when they're not good. I want you to think about this. There's another fella in the book of Luke who asks a similar question. In Luke chapter 18, we often refer to this guy as the rich young ruler. In Luke chapter 18, in verse 18, a ruler asks Jesus, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He's asking the same question as the lawyer. Jesus says to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone." Of course, Jesus is trying to get at the point that this ruler does not really understand what he's saying, but that's for a different sermon. He says, you know the commandments, don't commit adultery, don't murder, don't steal, don't bear false witness, honor your father and mother. He said, all these I've kept from my youth. Now I want us to understand what's going on is that the rich young ruler is here seeking to justify himself. He said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus says to him, keep these commands. How does the ruler strive to justify himself? I've done that. I'm good. Yes. Now there's a whole nother lesson to be had here because what is demonstrated is that in fact he has not kept the commands. But again, that's another sermon we can talk about some other time. Brian or Adam can preach that one for you. I want us to see the contrast. The rich young ruler, in seeking to justify himself and seeking to make himself look good and seeking to, okay, I've asked this question, things are good. He says, I did that. You know, the lawyer could have said that. When he said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself, and Jesus says, do that and you'll live. He could have said, I've been doing that from my youth up, just like the rich young ruler did. But that's not what he says. What he says is, who's my neighbor? Do you understand what that means? That means the lawyer knows he hasn't kept that law. The lawyer could have said like the rich young ruler did. But he knows, I haven't been doing this. And now I have to justify why I haven't been doing this. God hasn't been clear. Had God been clear and let me know exactly who my neighbor was, I would do what that command says because I want life. But God hasn't been clear. So, Jesus, can you tell me who is my neighbor? Then, once you've proven that, then I will be able to keep this command because I want to keep the commands and I keep the commands that I know and I understand. But I'm justified in not keeping this command because I don't know how. And he's seeking to justify himself. Here's my question for me and for you. Do we ever do that? Do you ever avoid even this command of loving your neighbor and then seek to justify yourself? Some kind of excuse, some kind of reason why it was okay not to be loving and compassionate and merciful in this instance? I know I do, and I know I have. And I'd like to put myself and all of us here tonight in the mirror of this story, looking at this lawyer and seeing what he said and what's going on here as he's seeking to justify himself. And I have no illusion that what I'm going to share with you tonight are all the potential excuses that anyone could make, but these are some of the excuses and justifications that I know I've made in my life. I don't necessarily expect you to remember all of these things or all the things that I say about them. I want us to grasp that sometimes we're busy trying to justify ourselves instead of just doing what we know God has asked us to do. And so I want to walk through with you some of these self-justifications that I know I have offered, and maybe you've offered them as well. And then when we're done, I'd like us to give some consideration to where justification really comes from. The first justification that I know that I have offered, I don't have enough information. That's the justification that the lawyer is offering. I don't have enough information. I know that God has said these things, but I don't understand them. I don't know about them. It's not clear. If there was just more information, then I could do more. And I think it was Mark Twain who supposedly said, it's not the parts of the Bible I don't understand that bother me. It's the parts that I do understand. And I think that's the thing that we need to grasp here. Certainly, as Jesus responds to this lawyer, what we learn from him is, rather than spending all our time making excuses and justifications about what we don't know, perhaps we should just spend our time doing what we do know. And here's what I know. I know that the Bible says I'm supposed to love God and I'm supposed to love my neighbor. And I may have all kinds of questions about particular instances. Am I supposed to do this here? Is this necessary? And I may not be able to answer all the ins and outs, but I tell you what I do know. I know I'm supposed to love people. And at the end of the day, I have to ask myself, when I'm done reacting and interacting with the folks who are in my life, I have to ask and answer the question, did I love them? Because if the answer to that question is no, all the other questions that I might ask about love and defining love and when it's love and when it's not love, that just doesn't matter. I have to ask, did I love them? And not just did I have some really nice emotional fluffy feeling towards them, but did I actively, compassionately, mercifully love this person that I was interacting with today? That's the question that I need to answer. I may not have all the information about everything, but that's no excuse not to love my neighbor. If I want to get away from loving them by saying I don't have enough information, then I'm just justifying and seeking to justify myself. Have you ever been there? Have you ever offered that one? I know I have. What about this second one? You can't prove I have to. You can't prove I have to do that. I mean, isn't that at the heart of what the lawyer had said? That's the same kind of justification I know I've offered plenty of times. Some kind of question about, do I have to do this? Do I have to do that? Those are the kind of questions we ask around this all the time. You can't prove I have to. Leave a lesson on the Good Samaritan and somebody walks out. Well, do I have to give money to every person who ever asked me for money? Do I have to stop for every car I see on the side of the road? Do I have to? Do I have to? You can't prove I have to. There's a couple of things that we need to think about with this. First of all, we need to understand that while the Scripture tells us to love, it doesn't always delineate every single loving particular action that's out there. And so, no, I can't always prove that any particular action has to be taken. But again, at the end of the day, even though I cannot give you all the ins and outs of every particular action that is loving, and so I can't, on most particular actions, I couldn't prove that you have to do those things. But I tell you what I can prove you have to do. You have to love your neighbor. And so again, at the end of the day, that's the question we have to ask and answer. Not did I have to do this particular action, but I did have to love them. When I'm done, can I say that? Can I say, would I be able to stand before God and say, yes, I loved them. I loved them the way you loved them. I loved them the way you would love them if you had been the one walking down that road and found them. But the second thing we need to understand about the idea of love is that love is not a have-to kind of thing. It's a get-to kind of thing. In fact, if I'm only doing it because I have to, do you know what that means it's not? It's not love. If I'm only doing it because you've proved that I have to, then I'm actually not loving the person. Let's think about this. Sisters, if you said to your husband, birthday's coming up. Boy, you know what I'd really love? I'd love a night on the town. I'd love a night on the town, and I'd like for us just to get away and spend the night at a hotel. We'll leave the kids with a babysitter, and we'll just go out on the town. We'll go to this restaurant. We'll spend the night at this hotel, and we'll just have a time away. I just need some time away. And your husband looked at you and said, well, do I have to? What would you think? Birthday comes and goes, and, you know, he gave you a weed eater. Well, you didn't say I had to. I mean, no, I guess you don't have to, but it would sure be nice. Would you feel loved? Well, what if he did do that, but the whole night it was just like, well, yeah, all right. I mean, you know, here it is, checklist. I have to do this. Guys, let me ask you, if you went to your wives and you said to them, look, I tell you what, I get so wound up at work, I want to come home and I want to be helpful, and I know you've had a tough day too, but I've got to have 15 minutes where I can just unwind so I can face the family and I can be what you need me to be and I can help. I just need 15 minutes. Give me 15 minutes to be able to go back into the bedroom and just sit there with my eyes closed for a few minutes, and then I'll come out and I'll help get dinner ready. I'll help with the kids. I'll do it. Just give me the 15 minutes, please. And she looked at you and said, well, do I have to? I mean, would that be love? And you say, well, no, I mean, you don't have to, but it sure would be helpful. I'd really like it. And day after day, it never happens. You see, when we're doing things because we have to, we all know that's not love. Now, I don't know what your wife wants or what your husband wants. That may hit your, those illustrations may hit your family. Those may be the exact opposite of what your spouse wants. I don't know. I'm just saying, if you went to your spouse and said, boy, I would love this, and they said, do I have to? We'd all know this one doesn't understand love. And yet, isn't that what we do with God all the time? Do I have to? Do I have to? No, I get to. I get to. That's love. Can't prove I have to. Well, I may not be able to, but if you're only doing it because I did prove it, well, that wasn't love anyway. What about this one? I don't want to do the wrong thing. What if I do something wrong? And I understand that. And this is a noble sounding excuse and justification, especially among our brethren. We are very concerned about making sure that we don't do things that are unscriptural. Now, let me be very clear. Don't do something unscriptural. I understand that. Don't do things that you know are wrong and sinful. Don't do that. But that's not what this question says. This question doesn't say, this excuse is not, well, that was a wrong thing, that was a sin, I wasn't going to do that. This, oh, I don't want to do the wrong thing. What if I do the wrong thing? I'm not going to do anything because I'm afraid I might do the wrong thing. Look in Matthew chapter 25. I think there's a great illustration in Matthew chapter 25. You might have heard Jesus' story about judgment, in which he talks about the different people that the master left in charge of different things. He gave to one 5 talents, he gave to another 2, and he gave to another 1, and left them in charge of those amounts of money, those resources. And he comes back, and the first one with the 5 talents bought and sold, and he brought him 5 more talents back. And the second one with the 2 talents bought and sold and invested and came back with 2 more talents. And the master blessed both of those men. But then we have the third guy, the guy with the 1 talent. And in verse 24, Matthew 25, 24, he also who had received the 1 talent came forward saying, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you didn't sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours. Do you grasp what this fellow is saying? This fellow is saying, I was afraid I was going to do the wrong thing. I was afraid that I was going to make the wrong investment and then I wouldn't have anything for you. I wouldn't even have the talent that you gave me. I was afraid that I was going to do the wrong thing. So I did nothing. Here's what the master says to him. Verse 26. His master answered him, You wicked and slothful servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown, gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at my coming I should have received what was my own with interest. So, take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10. For to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. What was his excuse? What was his justification? I was afraid I would do the wrong thing. And the master's response is, you should have at least done something. Again, this is no excuse for doing what we know is unscriptural and unauthorized. But when we sit back in paralysis and we do nothing, don't expect the master to be happy about it. I think about this with the good work of evangelism. I don't know how many times I've talked to people, well, you know, what about this idea? Oh, that won't work. Oh, we tried that back in the 60s. It didn't work. Our neighborhood, that wouldn't work. This wouldn't work. That wouldn't work. And so they do nothing. And you know what I know about doing nothing? It doesn't work. That's what I know. And what God's going to say is you should have at least done something. Hey, you know what? Maybe it is the wrong thing. Maybe nobody will respond. But you should have at least done something. Ah, what if I do the wrong thing? Don't be the 1 talent man. At least do something. What about this one? Someone might take advantage of me. Someone might take advantage of me. And that would be awful. The worst thing in the world is if somebody would take advantage of me. This one's near and dear to my heart because, wow, 22 years ago, I was moving to Dyersburg, Tennessee. It was going to be my first full-time work as a preacher. And while I was unloading the truck, moving in stuff to the apartment that my soon-to-be wife and I were going to be, after we were married, we're going to be living in. I was moving in before she got there. Up walks this fella, and he tells me some kind of sob story and his needs. And I have to tell you, the first thing I thought was, yes, here's my first prospect. I'm going to baptize this guy my first week here. The elders and the church here are going to think I'm amazing. I mean, I'm not saying I had the best attitude about the whole thing, but that's what I was thinking. By the time it was done, this fella had taken me for $85. Now, 22 years ago, that was a whole lot more money than it is now, but I have to tell you, $85 even for me now is nothing to sneeze at. But that was more than I made in a day. That was like I had worked for a day and a half, and he got it. That's what that was. And I decided then, I am never letting that happen again. People are not going to ever take advantage of me again. And I had to come to realize something. Nobody ever goes to hell for being taken advantage of. But some of us will lose our souls because we don't love our neighbors. And I have to understand that. If somebody takes advantage of me, I'm not the one who sinned. I loved. I was compassionate. You know what? Jesus came into the world to be loving and compassionate. He made himself vulnerable. And what did people do? They took advantage of him and they nailed him to a cross. What's 85 bucks compared to that? I have to understand. People will take advantage. And you just need to grasp that. People will take advantage. You let them into your home, they're going to break things. You give them money, they're going to misuse it. You give them your time, they'll take it for granted. You share the gospel with them, they'll throw it back in your face. Those things are going to happen. But nobody gets lost for other people taking advantage of us. Where we lose our souls is when we cease to love God and love the people God's made. That's what we need to grasp. Someone might take advantage of me. Awesome. That means I'm becoming much more like my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. What about this one? This is one that kind of builds off this, but boy, I sure would hate to be a poor steward. I don't want to be a poor steward. When we say I don't want to be a poor steward, we may be using that same last excuse. Someone might take advantage of me. Well, it would be just terrible stewardship, if, especially when we're talking about money or time, if I were to give money or time to somebody and they use that to sin. Now, listen, I don't want you enabling anybody to sin. God doesn't want you enabling and empowering people to sin. I understand that. And we're going to talk tomorrow evening about some boundaries and some priorities that I hope will help us answer some of those questions. Certainly. We don't want to be reckless, we don't want to be careless, we don't want to be prodigal, we don't want to enable folks to sin. But I do need to remember, again, if someone takes advantage of me, who's the one that sinned there? Not me. I remember my dad told me a story. After he got out of the Air Force in Blytheville, Arkansas, he was a heating and air fella. And so he opened up, he worked for a company for a while and then opened up his own business for a while, TC's Refrigeration. And he was working on, I think this may have been the local Piggly Wiggly, I can't remember, but he was working on some grocery store refrigeration unit, working up on their roof, maybe installing something or repairing something. It was taking all day, so at lunch he went down and there was a barbecue stand outside of that, whichever grocery store it was he was working at. Bought himself some lunch and he turned around and there was a fellow that said, "Hey man, you got $5? I haven't eaten all day. I'd like to eat. I'd like to eat." And my dad said to him, "I tell you what, I'm not going to give you $5, but I'll buy you a sandwich." And the guy said, "Okay, all right, I'll take a sandwich. That'll be great." So he turned around, he bought him a lunch, gave it to him, went back up on the roof. Dad ate his lunch, did his work, he came back down. The fellow at the barbecue stand said, "Hey, I need to tell you something. That fellow that you bought that lunch for, he turned around and sold it to the guy in line behind him and took the money." Who sinned there? I can tell you this, it wasn't my dad. Was he a poor steward? Absolutely not. He was loving, compassionate. The poor steward was the guy who sold the thing and then took that money and did whatever sin he did with it. Here's the second thing that we need to understand, though, about this stewardship. Unfortunately, even with all the good advice that we often hear today about stewardship, many of us have misunderstood what the number one rule of stewardship is. I love Dave Ramsey, I love Larry Biquette, I love these guys and the things that they say about it, but unfortunately, when we get done listening to them, sometimes what we think being a good steward means is making sure that you've saved up a lot of money and have a good retirement. And we think that those who are good stewards who have been able to accomplish that. Sometimes that's what good stewards accomplish, but that is not the definition of good stewardship. We need to understand what stewardship is. Stewardship does not equal being good with money. Stewardship means you are in control of something that somebody else actually owns. That's what a steward is. A steward is somebody who is managing and controlling what somebody else owns. When I grasp that, I understand that the number one principle of stewardship is doing what the person who owns it said to do with it. That's the number one principle of stewardship. Good investing is not the number one principle of stewardship. Doing what the person who owns the thing, that's the number one principle. Look in Luke 18 again. You remember that guy we call the rich young ruler? In Luke chapter 18, he comes to Jesus. He said, "What does I need to do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said, "Keep these commandments." He said, "I have." And then in verse 22, when Jesus heard this, he said to him, this is Luke 18, 22. When Jesus heard this, he said to him, "One thing you still lack, sell all that you have and distribute to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me." But when he heard these things, he became very sad, for he was extremely rich. By modern standards of supposed stewardship, this rich young ruler was an amazing steward. He had lived like nobody else, so he could live like nobody else. He could give a lot, but he refused to give everything. And the point is that the one who owned his stuff actually told him, "Give everything." And so he was a terrible, awful steward. Because the one who owned his stuff, which, by the way, that was the purpose of that whole, "Why do you call me good?" And why are you calling me good? Because in reality, you can't look at Jesus and just say he's good. You're either going to have to say that he's a crazy nut job, or he's exactly what he claimed to be. He's God. And if you're going to go to him as a good teacher, you have to be able to say he's God. And if he's God, when he tells you to sell everything, you sell everything. Now, brothers and sisters, I understand. This passage does not say that every person who's ever a Christian has to sell everything they have and give it to the poor. That's not what it says. We can go to other passages that talk about different principles, and I understand that. But I do know about this fellow, the one who owned his stuff. What did he say do with it? Sell it. Give it to the poor. Every bit of it. Why? Because this is what was keeping him from God. Now, I just want us to understand, here's a guy that by modern standards we'd say was a great steward, but he was actually terrible. Because the number one principle of stewardship is do what the person who owns it said do with it. And do you know what the Lord has told us to do with the stuff he's given us? With our time, with our resources, with our houses, with our cars, with our relationships. I'll tell you what he's told us to do with it. Love your neighbor. It is never poor stewardship to love your neighbor. Ever. Well, what if I give so much that in the end someone's having to take care of me? You know, interestingly, when the Bible was written, there was no such thing as Social Security. There was no such thing as 401k. What they expected is people were going to get old and they weren't going to be able to work and other people were going to have to take care of them. I'm not saying it's wrong for us to have those things. I'm just saying we ought to think through this thing. Because sometimes we think through it like modern Americans and not like the people Jesus said these things to. Sometimes we get to love others, sometimes others are loving us. We're going to talk tomorrow about boundaries. We're going to talk about priorities. I understand there's the principles that in the house of the wise there are precious treasures and stores of oil and wine. I understand all that, and we've got to fit all this together. But I do want us to understand it's never poor stewardship to love our neighbor, because that's what the owner of our stuff has told us to do. Love your neighbor. What about this? Ha, I don't even know this person. I don't even know this person. You know, I mean, if it was somebody that I knew, I would love them. I would take care, but I don't even know this person. Think of a couple of illustrations of this. Think of it this way. Say you had a friend that just got their job as a waiter or waitress. And you're going to go with a group of Christians and you got for their first night, you're going to go show some support and you're going to help this person and you plan on when the meal's done, you're going to give them a great big tip to show them the support. And then you get there and the meal gets messed up. They serve the wrong things. It's undercooked. It's not right. She actually poured your tea on you. But you know, by the time it's done, that's still the person you know. And you know, hey, it's a tough night. It's first night. I understand. I'm still going to give that big old tip because I love him and I'm going to care for him. But what if it's just a normal night and it's somebody that you don't know? And they're having a bad night, but instead of saying, hey, they're having a bad night, I'm going to support them anyway. Oh, it's terrible. I'm not giving them anything. They're just awful and rotten. Isn't that amazing? Somebody we know, we might do something nice for. Somebody we don't know, we treat them completely different. Now, the reason why I continue to use that illustration is because the first time I used it in Brownsburg, somebody came up to me afterwards who said, hey, I was a waitress for however many years, and she said, I have to tell you, Christians are some of the absolute worst tippers I know. And so I just keep using that illustration because I want to let you know, people notice. And you know, and she said it was actually kind of like that Christian discount thing we were talking about the other night. Hey, we're brothers and sisters. You can get by without me tipping you, right? How about in those instances we say, you know what, I'm going to go ahead and give a little bit more. Here's another illustration. This one catches me all the time, and my kids like to catch me in this one because I still do this, and got to stop myself. Several years ago, I was taking a vacation with a group of Christians in Gatlinburg, Tennessee. Anybody been in Gatlinburg, Tennessee? Actually, we were in Pigeon Forge, but in that area, we were in Pigeon Forge, and we would spend some time together in the day, but then there would be times when we'd all go off and do our own separate things, and you guys who have been there, you know what the traffic is like in Pigeon Forge. Those people do not know how to drive, and I was making a turn. I can't remember now exactly what was going to happen, but somebody cut in front of me and cut me off and turned into the restaurant that we were turning into, and I hollered out something. I don't know. I called him a name. I didn't cuss, but I called him some kind of name, you know, that I'm not going to repeat because I know you tell your kids not to call those people those names, and you don't want the preacher having said those things. And we pulled in, and then they got out of the car, and it was some of our friends from the vacation we were with. And I turned around and I looked at my kids and I said, don't you dare tell them what I said. But you know, the funny thing was, as soon as I saw who it was, I was no longer angry. It was like, oh, that's just so-and-so. All of a sudden, they weren't dumb. They weren't any of those things that I was saying about them. They just made a mistake, because I know what that's like. You ever made a mistake while you're driving? You ever accidentally cut somebody off while you were driving? Yeah, we've all done that. We've all done that. As soon as it was the person that I knew, I was willing to give them the benefit of the doubt. But before that, they think they own the road, and who do they think they are? You see what's happening there? Isn't it interesting how sometimes we'll be willing to give the benefit of the doubt to people we know, but to people we don't know, cutting the legs right out from under them? The point I want to make is that, hey, folks are the same. They all make mistakes. Everybody has bad days. Perhaps what we should do is love them and give them the benefit of the doubt, whether we know them or not. Perhaps we should go the extra mile and love them and be merciful and compassionate whether we know them or not. That's the thing that we need to grasp. Oh, what about this one? Last one. Well, they got themselves into this mess. They can get themselves out. We mentioned this last night, didn't we? They got themselves in this mess. They can get themselves out. You know, who knows? Maybe this is the person that needs a shoulder to cry on because their sins have destroyed their marriage. Maybe this is the person that just needs some time because they've made some really bad decisions and their life is in shambles, and they need someone who can spend some time with them counseling and advising and helping them put the pieces back together. Maybe this is somebody who has made some terrible, awful financial mistakes and just done some very dumb things with their money, and now they need some financial help. Or maybe this is somebody who has just sinned in awful, terrible ways, and what they need is the gospel. How often do we look at folks, and rather than loving and caring and being compassionate and merciful, we stand in judgment? And that's a subtle form of pride. That's a subtle form of pride that says, you know, if I ever needed help or I ever needed love, I would deserve it. Look in Luke chapter 7. There's a great story there that demonstrates this principle. In Luke chapter 7, Jesus is invited to eat in the home of a Pharisee. And in Luke 7 and verse 37, behold, a woman of the city who was a sinner. And a lot of folks think that that means she must have been a prostitute. When she learned that he was reclining at table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment, and standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head and kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment. And when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would have known what sort of woman this is who's touching him, for she's a sinner. What Simon is subtly saying there is that he had the right to touch Jesus, because he wasn't a sinner like that woman. This woman has no right because she's a sinner. She got into this mess herself. But me, I'm righteous. Somebody asked the question today at lunch, how do you love the unlovable? Boy, that's a tough question. And the only way I know to answer that is I got to spend some time thinking about how much God loved me. And then I've got to be a little bit honest about how unlovable I actually am. Because unfortunately, I spend too much time thinking I'm the lovable one, instead of realizing how amazing it is that when Jesus looked down at me, he could have said, he got himself into this mess. He can get himself out. That's not what he said. And again and again and again, even after becoming a Christian, I get myself into messes. And Jesus is saying, turn to me. Like Peter, who got out of the boat and walked on the water, and then he began to sink. But what did he do? He turned back to Jesus. Lord, save me! And what did Jesus say? You had your chance? No, he lifted him back up. You realize Peter walked on the water twice? That's amazing. They got themselves into this mess. Well, yeah, of course they did. So did we. Again, I'm not saying be reckless and careless. Don't enable sin. But perhaps we need to think a little bit more about how much God has loved us. And so my question for you is, how often have you been seeking to justify yourself instead of just loving your neighbor? How are you doing at that? You can put your notes away now if you'd like. Please pull out your songbook at this time. Number 343, let him have his way with thee. Number 343. I'm sure I could have listed a whole bunch of other excuses that I have offered, and maybe there's some that you can think of that aren't on this list. I just wanted us to get the idea and get us looking in the mirror and thinking about ourselves. And yes, listen, I understand. As we've said all the way along, some of this produces more questions. that we have to struggle with and we have to wrestle with. And I think that's one of the reasons that God answers questions the way he does sometimes. Rather than just saying, look, here's the line, he makes us struggle and he makes us wrestle because that's what makes us grow. If he just said, here's the line, too many of us would just spend our time trying to get close to the line, but he doesn't do that. And so what we have to do is spend our time figuring out how to get close to him. And that's what we need to be doing. And the reason why this story causes me so much problems and a lesson like tonight just challenges me so much is because I realize that, frankly, I spend too much time being like the lawyer, seeking to justify myself. I spend too much of my time trying to prove to God that I really do deserve to get into heaven. And the more I do that, the more I run headlong into that wall that says, I just don't. And when I stand before him in judgment, there's no amount of church going, there's no amount of having gotten baptized, there's no amount of how much money I put in the plate, there's no amount of how much money I gave to a person on the side of the road, there's no amount of any of those things that when I stand before him is going to say, yep, this guy deserves it. Because I have blown it too much. And there is absolutely no way for me to justify myself. And so I need to just quit seeking to do that. And instead recognize that Jesus came into the world to justify me. He went to the cross so that by his blood and by his sacrifice, we could be justified. And that's not permission to not love our neighbor. That's the strength and the power to grow in love for God and my neighbor. And I want to ask you, have you been seeking to justify yourself? You know, really, this gets down to the question of why are you here tonight? Why are you here tonight? Are you here tonight because you hope when you stand before God in judgment, this will be on the tally board of good things that you've done that might count for something? While everybody else is out partying or doing whatever else it is they're doing, you were here, and hey, God, doesn't that count for something? Are you here because you're hoping to impress God with your righteousness? You know, we're talking about the God who created the world in 6 days. Do you think showing up to church on one of those days is going to cause him to say, whoa, I got to let you in. You're amazing. Are you here because you're hoping to impress God, or are you here because you have been so impressed by God? Because you want to be with him, and you know that gathering with his people is going to be with him. Why are you here? We got to quit seeking to justify ourselves. Jesus has sought to justify us. Are you in Jesus Christ? Jesus said, he that believes and is baptized will be saved. Why? Because being baptized is so impressive to God? No, absolutely not. In fact, it amazes me that people even think that. Oh, you're trying to work your way into heaven by having somebody dunk you underwater. I don't understand that. That's not it at all. You're not even doing something. You're having somebody do something to you. And that actually perfectly illustrates what's happening. As you are being immersed in the water, physically, you are being immersed in God spiritually. And it's his work that saves you. And so will you respond to him, not because you're trying to impress him with your righteousness, but because you are so impressed by his work and his power that you'll just do what he says. We're going to give you that opportunity tonight. We're going to ask you to let him have his way with thee. That's what we're going to be singing, and we're singing it to you. If we can help you, let him have his way with thee. We'll invite you to come forward right now as we stand and sing.